In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Be seated. Well, again, Happy New Year. Today, the first day of the year, is filled with hope. It's a wonderful day where most of us probably haven't broken our resolution once yet. And if your resolution was to attend church more regularly, good for you. You're batting 100. But it is a day where we're filled with optimism for the year to come, where we've made a dedicated effort to do something differently, to walk out from 2016 in some different way with the thoughts of improving our lives or the lives of those around us, and it's filled with possibility. And I think that's not far from the way that we think about naming our child. I've been thinking a lot this week about what it is to name your child. What it was to go through the ritual that Jesus went through of being named, even though the angel had already given his name. But what is it that we go through when we name our children? And I talked on Christmas Eve about the fortunate correction that my parents made when they sought out to name me Christopher and realized that me, the first non-Jewish person born in my family, would be named Christmas. And so they, at the last minute, changed it to Benjamin, which is a good Jewish name, by the way. And I thought about when we named our children, when Elliot was still in the womb with months to go, we settled on the name of Elliot, and from that point on, he developed a personality even before we ever were able to hold him in our hands. We cultivated an idea of who Elliot was around that name. And with Laura, it was a little more complicated as we wrestled over names, and Anna wasn't going to leave her name, and I wasn't going to leave my name that I had settled until we rushed to the hospital a week too early, which happened to be the birthday of her twin sisters, Laura and Lee. And we said, well, if we have the baby today, then we'll name it Laura Lee. And we both agreed to it, and then the doctor sent us home and said, just wishful thinking. And so when we came back a week later, we decided that that was going to be the name. And from that point on, she has grown into being Laura Lee, and whether that's because she's grown into what our perception of what the name Laura Lee is, or whether or not the name has shaped her. But when we came up with either of those names, they're filled with hope for this child. We are starting to dream for this child before this child has stepped into the earth, before this child has had any capacity to realize any of these dreams. We have set these dreams before. And I think of the name of Jesus, and Jesus going through that ritual of being named. In there, they had the practice of waiting 8 days. And if you read in the Genesis 17, that God tells Abraham that all the children are to be circumcised, all the male children are to be circumcised on the 8th day. And that was when they were officially named. And the girls had a naming ceremony that basically they were often named at the first reading of the Torah after their birth. But there was something in that process of naming this child, filling this child with all of the hopes for the generations to come and placed upon this child. And so when I think about today, as I think about naming, I think about the hope that took place, that Mary and Joseph had for this child, realizing that they were bringing the Son of God, the Savior of the world, all wrapped in bands of cloth. And then the second thing I thought of is what they named him. Jesus. Now certainly the angel had told him to name him Jesus, but think about what that meant for turning things upside down. And this time I'm talking about the incarnation, what we celebrate about God being with us. God with us in the flesh. And the way that the name shows how much things have tilted. Remember back in the Hebrew tradition, you couldn't even say the name of God. God was too holy to even echo his name. I am who I am. So distant and so beyond humanity that even to utter his name would send trembling. And they gave Jesus a fairly common name. There's over 70 tombs from the time where Jesus lived with the name of Jesus, which comes from the name of Joshua, which means chosen or anointed one. But how many of us as parents haven't named our children something that's sort of like anointed or chosen one? Our hopes are a little optimistic for our children. But it was a fairly common name. And all of a sudden, God, who is beyond the ability to utter his name, is a crying baby boy and is circumcised with a common name like John or Joshua. And part of it, when I think of this name, individual is the fullness of which God came into our existence. The way that God came into our life. With the fears and the anxieties that we have as parents, with what it is to be a child, with the fullness of entering human creation, of being where we are, of heaven dipping that low, we have that in this very tangible, concrete ritual that every Jewish boy has done. Third thing is I think of naming. I think of what it says about God. God's investment in Jesus was full before he got the name of Jesus. But I was thinking this past week as we laid to rest our beloved sister Frances, and I thought about the difference between this liturgy that we use to celebrate her entrance into the land of light and joy from what would have been in the 28th prayer book, where there was no mention of name. Gender was as personal as the liturgy got. There often wasn't a eulogy, and the theology behind it was whether you were the king of England or homeless or sick, you had the exact same liturgy. That the great leveler was our place in God's kingdom, our place in God's eyes. And there's a beautiful theology there, but I think there's also a beautiful theology when you heard the name Francis mentioned, that he realized that to God, this was the unique daughter of God, Francis. You realize that each of us are uniquely loved by God, uniquely God's child. That spirit of adoption we read about is present for each of us. And it's not just a general encapsulation of God loves all of us, but every hair on your head, every experience you've had, that first whimper as a child, that first anxiety of what do I do with this child as a parent, all of that has been seen and honored and loved by God. That God loves us uniquely. And that our names matter. That our stories matter. God so fully entered creation so that we would know that we matter. So what's in a name? That God is that love so that we know that God is always with us, that God has walked the path that we have walked. So that we know that we matter to God. So that we know, like when we hold that child and give that child the name that we've given or that we've been given, that hope that fills that moment, pregnant hope that God has for all of us. Full of promise. Full of hope. Full of investment. Amen.